ladies and gentlemen. He's a child of God, a husband, NRA conservative, radical right-wing supervillain, and Twitter rock star. American by birth, Texan by choice, and a badass by nature. He's the owner of TomOHalloran.com, OHalloranMedia.com, and PatriotRadio.net. Please welcome Tom O'Halloran.
And good morning, America. Welcome to the Patriot Radio Show. I'm your host, Tom O'Halloran. And I'm broadcasting today from my underground bunker deep in Arcantana, Brascarado. I'm here to educate, irritate, and agitate. In fact, if you're not fully agitated by the time this show's over, you'll get triple your money back at the door. Again, my name's Tom O'Halloran. My primary blog, TomOHalloran.com. When you get there, please follow me on Facebook, Twitter, Spreaker, any other social media that you fancy. Facebook. We're at facebook.com/Patriot Radio Show. You personally, you can find me on Facebook at facebook.com/O'Halloran. And we do this show five times a week. So please tune in Monday through Thursday for this, the Patriot Radio Show. On Fridays, we do Jihad on America. Here I cover the Islamists in America, sharing with you who they are, what they want, and why you should be afraid. I'm just reading the chat room here. Bill, are you going to call in or what? Because I had planned on a conversation with my good friend Bill Perryman, who's now saying that his phone is not working. This is a mess. Folks, I really don't have a show today. I'm up at 6 a.m. doing show prep and getting ready for the show, have a stack of stories to cover. And today was one of those rare days when I just couldn't get my head into the game, and I knew I had a co-host on, and it's much, much easier doing that with a co-host, because we can just pick a story and have a conversation, which is a lot easier and a lot less structured. But without a co-host, I really have to have a lot more show prep done for it. So we're going to take a bye on the show for today. I don't want to sit here and just stammer and grasp at straws. The score, Hillary still sucks. Donald Trump is still number one. He's still beating Hillary. My score for the electoral vote contest, I still have him pegged to get 429. Don't worry about it, Brother Bill. Things happen. I've missed a show before because of all of a sudden get ready to go live and I have no... Mike, if you're up for it, give a call in. Give a call in, brother. We can do that. Okay, looks like we're going to have a show here after all. My Tuesday co-host, Mike Nelson, will be joining me. And we're going to fake a show for it. I got a phone call coming in from New York. That's not Mike. We're going to pass on that one. And we're going to take the next phone call that comes in. And we're going to go do a show with Mike Nelson. Like I said, these guys know what's going on. We can have a conversation on half a dozen different stories. Anyway, if you did not catch my show on the Muslim Brotherhood, my show Islam is Not a Religion, or my show on Islamophobia, then please find your way to PatriotRadioShow.com. Catch all three of these shows. They'll give you insight. They'll give you perspective on the Islamic topic that you've probably not heard elsewhere. They'll also give you a solid foundation upon which we build each and every Friday as we continue to pull back the mask of Islam, looking at what's being done in the name of Allah, both here and abroad. And I do the news about Islam around the world because it's a glimpse into the future. of what's in store for us here in America if we continue to allow the cancer of Islam to spread. Keep abreast of my shows, listen to the live stream, as well as catch up on the archives of any shows you may have missed, all at PatriotRadioShow.com. This show is rebroadcast daily at ConfederateBroadcasting.com, at ConservativeRadioNetwork.com, at LibertyWorks Radio Network, and at RedNationRising.us. You can also take the show on the road with you with your iPhone or Android. Just download the TuneIn app and do a search for the Patriot Radio Show. And with that, we're going to go straight to my phone and take a phone call from a friend of mine that never lets me down, unlike the other guy. Billy, you're there, brother. Mike, you there, brother? Okay, we got a... Are you there, Mike?
Hello?
There you are. There you are.
I had it on mute, sorry. Oh. My bad. Hey, Bill, you're going to owe me one, buddy.
I just need to get some better friends. I got one that won't call and one that calls but puts his phone on mute. My pals are hanging me out to dry. Anyway, yeah, it was a little technical thing. Bill's been here with me since 6 a.m. We've been reading news stories. We've been talking back and forth, stuff we're going to talk about and this, that, and the other thing. And when I do a show, I'll typically pick 10... 12, sometimes 15 different stories, print them out. I've got them here to shuffle between. When I take a commercial break, I'll reorder them and stuff like that. When I'm doing a conversational show, which I do more of this last month and a half since I've been having you guys on, I don't print anything out. So I'll read stuff. I got a feel of what's going on, but I'm not nearly as prepared. And when one so-called friend bails on you at the last instant as you're already playing your intro music, and threw me for a bit of a loop. So anyway, how's things over in your area, Iowa?
Oh, pretty good, pretty good. We're going to have a beautiful day here today.
Boy, I tell you what, down here in Arkansas, Brascarada, we're at 65 degrees. My last two days, I've had my doors open all day long. That as opposed to like upper 90s with 80% humidity, so this is real
nice. Yeah, I hear you.
Real
yesterday
nice.
It was a little chilly, but today it's going to be like upper 60s, lower 70s, perfect weather for me.
Yeah, I'm digging it. So we've still got Hillary lying about her performance in the debates. The Democrats still saying that she won, but we've got Democrats saying that she's been lying. Even the Democrats are outing her for the lies that she told during the debates.
Well, they had the moderator there that didn't fact check Hillary. And it seems like, of course, we're not surprised.
Right.
The media and the moderators are, they're Democrats and they picked their side.
Yeah, we need to come up with a better way to pick moderators, because it's just been so one sided for as long as I can remember. Now,
I was thinking maybe some people from the Heritage Foundation or constitutional think tanks.
Well, see, you're not,
just get these network people out of there.
Right, but you're not going to get that approved by the other side. So maybe somebody from the Heritage Foundation and someone from American Progress. So at least each one of us can have a...
There you go.
Each one of us can
fair
have...
Fair and balanced.
Each side can have somebody that will be attacking the other. But also some rules for the moderators. Ask questions. None of these follow-up questions. The score that I remember was, what's his name? Leftist Holtz asked 6 questions to both of the candidates. Then he had 2 questions he asked to just Hillary. And he had 17 questions he asked to just Donald Trump, plus several follow-up questions to Donald Trump, no follow-up questions to Hillary. Plus, he interrupted Donald Trump 41 times, and he interrupted Hillary like twice. So it was very, very, very lopsided. And he also, the fact-checking that he did on Donald Trump was wrong on several occasions. So if you guys,
I tell you,
if you're going
to, I think we ought to look into maybe putting electrodes in the seat of the moderator. You know, when he pulls that stuff, you hit the button, give him a mild jolt of electricity. You know,
right?
Just like a correction, like a dog collar. You know, those training collars.
Yep. And before the debate, he told the audience, "No applause, no noise." When Hillary said something, they got laughter. It was okay. When Donald Trump said something about the deleted emails and the crowd erupts, he shuts them up.
Yep.
I mean, on every measure, this guy was off the charts. Now, having said that, I saw a video put together where somebody was showing, they fast forward, then they show a segment where Donald Trump was talking, and they were claiming that Hillary was giving leftist Holt signals, like she'd scratch below her eye alongside of her nose, and that was supposedly a cue for the moderator to throw it to her for a softball so she could get in a zinger. And sure enough, within 30 to 60 seconds, he'd throw it to her. And this was a real thing. I mean, they were all upset. And right after she does that, within a minute, he gives it to her. Wait a minute. Who else is he going to give it to? I mean, there's no question he was in the bag for her. But who's he going to give it to? They each have a minute to a minute and a half to answer a question. She scratches her eye, and within a minute, Holt gives it to her. Of course he gives it to her. It's her turn. So our side is going off the rails looking for conspiracies. There was a picture of her with a wire going down the inside of her back. They both wore lapel pins. Of course they were mic'd up. It didn't mean somebody was in her ear telling her what to say. Not that she hasn't done that before. But, I mean, come on, people. Pick the real things to talk about. Not these supposed secret signs between her and the moderator.
Hey, Tom.
Yeah.
I just posted something on in the chat room there.
I'm opening it.
One about Ginsburg. And the other one is about this so-called cleaner that was caught in a photograph there that basically works for Hillary. I wondered if these candidates went on the stage without being checked for earwigs, you know, like we know that Hillary did during the commander-in-chief debate.
Right. Well, I don't know. I saw some close-ups that was suggested on, and I don't believe they had it during this debate. And also, going back to the commander-in-chief thing, because I really bought into that one, the photos that they were showing that were zoomed in where you could see that, if you look at that, and do a little research on this, because I saw it just yesterday, the photos where you could actually see the bug in her ear, that was not at the debate. The background was actually, they zoomed in so you didn't see much of what the background was, but the background was actually her standing outside an airplane talking to the media crew.
Oh, crap, man. You ruined it.
Yeah. No, I know. I want to rake her over the coals. I want to pummel her. Okay? I mean, I'm not saying I hate the woman, but I would unplug her life support to charge my cell phone. But
you know,
I want
to... We got to hold ourselves to a higher standard. We know that the liberals lie and cheat and do that sort of thing. And, you know, we got to be better than that.
Exactly. If she's wearing a mic, man, I'll talk about it every day on the show. And I did on that one. I talked about it a couple of times. But when I see that it's not the truth, I don't want to be that guy that keeps propagating falsehoods, even if it's against the opponent. And I think we need to rise above that. If it looks like something's going down, I'll look into it. If it looks real, I'll talk about it. But if it comes up that it's not real, you know, I'm going to straighten it out. I want it to be an honest fight. I mean, I want it to be a bloody fight. I want to see your carcass being chewed on by hyenas. But
staked out for cougar bait.
Right. But I don't want to do it by saying that she's cheating where she's not. And this fixer came up to the podium and picked up her papers. I don't know what notes she had there, but you have staffers to clean up after you. What's she going to do? Walk off the stage? She can't walk around carrying her notes. I don't know what notes they are. They're allowed to bring or not. Are they not allowed to have notes? But if you walk off and leave your stuff, one of your staffers should pick up after you. So I'm not going to go down that conspiracy road either. We don't know what the notes are. You know, is it the questions that the moderator is going to be asking? Did he leak them to the campaign ahead of time? I've heard they did. I don't know. But we can't just jump on, it's a fixer, picked up the questions in the sequence they were being asked and all that. We don't know. So far, all we know is that one of her staffers picked up after her, which is what staffers are supposed to do, right?
Yeah.
Okay, I mean, she's a piece of human feces. I agree with that. But let's stick to stuff that's factual.
Yeah, you know, leave the tinfoil hats behind.
Yeah, yeah. Let's
let's
get her on the issues. Get her on the dead bodies that are around her. We know that's factual stuff. Get her on the lies that she told. Virtually everything she said from the podium was a lie. Her mannerisms, she was obviously on some carefully concocted cocktail with all of her giggling and shimmying.
Maybe she, she'd been having that coughing problem, but we haven't. She keeps the press at such an arm's length, it's hard to know what goes on with her from a day-to-day basis until she comes out into the public.
Right.
And we don't know what prep they have done with her. And like, there for a while back, she was coughing. You know, they can spray a numbing agent to the back of the throat, to numb the back of the throat. Then that helps with suppressing cough. You know, they could have used something like that.
Yeah, well, I think it's pretty much a sure thing that she was on some kind of a medical cocktail. And I'm sure they've been tweaking it for weeks, trying to get it to the point where she wouldn't just get up there and giggle, but neither would she let her head go nodding up, bouncing up and down like a bobblehead like she's done before either. So that part of it, they almost got tuned, but she was definitely high on something.
You ever notice when the media talks to Ivanka Trump, they ask, what is with your dad and the anti-woman thing, and that sort of stuff. But yet when they talk to Chelsea, they never asked her about her dad's behavior with women.
Right. And then they had this Machado gal that Hillary brought up. I watched a video this morning from 1995, when Machado was heavy. She had won the Miss Universe the year before, and she put on 60 pounds. And Trump called her Miss Piggy. He said she was heavy. The company that ran it, his company that ran it, wanted to boot her off, take away her crown. She can't go around the world being Miss Universe when she's 60 pounds overweight, for gosh sakes. And
there's a double standard here. You know, they talk about the war on women and that, but you know, there's plenty of women out there that would look at a guy carrying extra weight, and they put them in a bad light. Sure. Hey, look at that fat slob.
Well, here's the thing.
It's Trump is human nature.
This was a press, not conference, but like a press scrum, if you will. She is sitting right next to Trump. Trump is standing up. She's right next to him. He says she's absolutely the most beautiful woman I've ever seen. But she put on this extra weight. And rather than letting her go, we've got her into a program. And they said, do you work out? And he says, as little as I can get away with. I work out by playing sports. And Machado was laughing and blushing. She says, you can work out here with me any day. She's loving it. She is absolutely taken with
back in the limelight again.
Well, this was in 1995 when she was fat.
Oh.
This is then. This is when he was being abusive. They're calling it abusive. He was looking out for her rather than getting her fired. She had an eating disorder. She was under a lot of pressure, so she started pigging out. And he was there taking care of her. He got her a coach. He was on a track to get her to the point where when she turned the crown over in a few months, she would be a little bit heavier than she was when she took the crown, which is a better weight for her. But she's adoring him while he's supposedly abusing her. So the Clinton,
you know, there is the train of thought that talks about tough love. You know,
this wasn't even that. This was love.
I'm mainly referring to the statement, this Miss Piggy stuff.
Yeah, well, you know what? Even that, you can say that to her when you're fawning over and telling her how beautiful she is.
So you're saying that he helped her by getting her, you know, help with her eating disorder?
Right. He got her a coach that would help her with her eating situation. He fought to make sure that she kept the crown, and she loved him. You could watch this video, and I don't remember where I saw it. I saw it this very morning. I'll see if I can find it during our break, which we're going to take here in just a minute. But you could tell that he wasn't being abusive because she was fawning all over him and blushing.
Well,
Hillary has reached her and obviously paid her some money. And she's got the money because she basically stole $6 billion while Secretary of the State. And she bought this person. She bought this person and is claiming that he was mean to her, which is obviously not the case. We're going to take a quick break here. Please, don't walk off and make a run to the kitchen. Turn the radio up and listen to this message.
Unless you got to go to the bathroom.
And then only if you really, if you're not doing.
Crank up the volume so you can hear it.
If you're not doing the potty dance, you don't really got to go. So listen to this message. It's a powerful, powerful, beautiful piece.
It is. I wish they would do campaign commercials with it.
Absolutely. I mean, you wouldn't have to mention a name. Just play this thing on the air. You wouldn't have to have Trump's name or anything in it. They would understand. All right, my friend, stick around. It's the Patriot Radio Show on a Thursday morning with my good friend, my only good friend, Mike Nelson. We'll be right back.
I wanted America to fail, to follow, not lead, to suffer, not prosper, to despair, not dream. I'd start with energy. I'd cut off America's supply of cheap, abundant energy. I couldn't take it by force, so I'd make Americans feel guilty about using the energy that heats their homes, fuels their cars, runs their businesses, and powers their economy. I'd make cheap energy expensive, so that expensive energy would seem cheap. I would empower unelected bureaucrats to all but outlaw America's most abundant sources of energy. After banning its use in America, I'd make it illegal for American companies to ship it overseas. If I wanted America to fail, I'd use their schools to teach one generation of Americans that their factories and their cars will cause a new ice age. And I'd muster a straight face so I could teach the next generation that they're causing global warming. When it's cold out, I'd call it climate change instead. I'd imply that America's cities and factories could run on wind power and wishes. I'd teach children how to ignore the hypocrisy of condemning logging, mining, and farming while having roofs over their heads, heat in their homes, and food on their tables. I would never teach children that the free market is the only force in human history to uplift the poor, establish the middle class, and create lasting prosperity. Instead, I demonize prosperity itself so that they will not miss what they will never have. If I wanted America to fail, I would create countless new regulations and seldom cancel old ones that would be so complicated that only bureaucrats, lawyers, and lobbyists could understand them. That way, small businesses with big ideas wouldn't stand a chance. And I would never have to worry about another Thomas Edison, Henry Ford, or Steve Jobs. I would ridicule as flat earthers those who urge them to lower energy costs by increasing supply. And when the evangelists of common sense try to remind people about the laws of supply and demand, I'd enlist a sympathetic media to drown them out. If I wanted America to fail, I would empower unaccountable bureaucracy seated in a distant capital to bully Americans out of their dreams and their property rights. I'd send federal agents to raid guitar factories for using the wrong kind of wood. I'd force homeowners to tear down their own homes built on their own land. I'd make it almost impossible for farmers to farm, miners to mine, loggers to log, and builders to build. Because I don't believe in free markets, I'd invent false ones. I'd devise fictitious products like carbon credits and trade them in imaginary markets. I'd convince people that this would create jobs and be good for the economy. If I wanted America to fail, for every concern, I'd invent a crisis, and for every crisis, I'd invent the cause, like shutting down entire industries and killing tens of thousands of jobs in the name of saving spotted owls. And when everyone learned the stunning irony that the owls were victims of their larger cousins and not people, it would already be decades too late. If I wanted America to fail, I'd make it easier to stop commerce than to start it, easier to kill jobs than create them, more fashionable to resent success than to seek it. When industries seek to create jobs, I'd file lawsuits to stop them, and then I'd make taxpayers pay for my lawyers. If I wanted America to fail, I would transform the environmental agenda from a document of conservation to an economic suicide pact. I would concede entire industries to our economic rivals by imposing regulations that cost trillions. I would celebrate those who preach environmental austerity in public while indulging a lavish lifestyle in private. I convince Americans that Europe has it right and that America has it wrong. If I wanted America to fail, I would prey on the goodness and the decency of ordinary Americans. I would only need to convince them that all of this is for the greater good. If I wanted America to fail, I suppose I wouldn't change a thing.
Tom O'Halloran, holding the line against tyranny from Washington, D.C.
I am America, one voice, united we stand. I am America, one hope to heal our land. There is still work that must be done. I will not rest until we
Welcome back. It's the Patriot Radio Show on a Thursday morning. We're on air with my good friend Mike Nelson. Mike, let's revisit the debate for a couple of minutes.
Alrighty.
We had a debate where a lot of America was really expecting Trump to come out and clean the floor with Hillary. And he threw a couple of punches, but he left a lot on the table. He didn't attack her on so many different subjects that he could have. And Ken was all upset over this on Monday, although he called me late Monday and said that he had an epiphany and he felt that Trump did exactly what he needed to do.
Yeah, he called me too. We had a conversation on the same lines.
And I was like, well, this you call an epiphany? Were you not on the show with me this morning? It's kind of what I was saying all along. To me, that...
Well, I think he needed to think about it and digest it.
Yeah.
Well, that's what he said to me anyway. He said after he thought about it for a while. You know, and I think, you know, the next morning in that after a debate, maybe it's too soon. I think you need to think about it for a little bit, you know, and digest it and kind of see the response of the media in that.
Yeah.
And you might change your mind. About certain things.
He
had a good theory,
yeah.
Ken did, saying that who remembers the first debate?
Yeah.
Well, there may be some, you know, some logic to that. Maybe he's saving his ammunition for the second, or most importantly, the last one, when it's fresh in the mind of the voters to really lay some zingers on her.
Yeah, the later ones are more important because you're down to the wire. my take on it was this, and it's basically the same thing. And this is what I said on Monday. It was like a resume. If you're applying for a job, you don't put everything you have into your resume. You put enough to pique their interest, to make them think that, yeah, this guy could do the job. This looks like he's got what it's going to take. And they want you to come in. They want to see more of you. Okay? Trump's mission wasn't to come out and knock her out in front of 80 to 100 million people. The later debates will have more people. His mission was to come out, look somewhat presidential, to fight enough to make people think, you know what? This guy might have it after all. I'm going to tune into the next debate. Now, we're going to have 2 weeks before the next debate. People are going to be talking. Did you see this? Did you hear that? He looked pretty good. I mean, he was this, he was that, and he came out with this. And more people are going to tune out for the next debate. The next debate is the meeting where you go in for your interview, where you're there before the whole team. And I think on the next debate, he is going to mop the floor with her.
Well, I've heard that we know that Ted Cruz has basically done a mea culpa and has endorsed Donald Trump now. I've heard that he has offered his services as debate coach. What have you heard about that, Tom?
I've heard nothing. I've heard, and I haven't read it, so it's not on the blogs that I read. Now, there's about 20, 25 blogs I read on a very consistent basis. And I haven't seen it there, but I've heard on the TV in the other room that my wife watches, mainstream media, that there is an insider in the Trump campaign that is saying Trump's performance lies with only one person, and that's Donald Trump. I've got a feeling that somewhere on one of these fake news websites, there's somebody supposedly inside the campaign that's saying we blew it and it's Donald Trump's fault. I don't think he's got anybody on his team that would do this. So I don't think it's real. If it was real, I think I would have seen it on Breitbart, The Hill, Right Side News. It would have been all over the place. So I don't know. But
I don't think it would do him any harm to take some coaching on debating.
Brother?
Because, you know, he wrote a book, The Art of the Deal.
Yeah.
You know, that's his strong point. And there's also an art to debate.
Brother,
he is taking
coaching. Look at his debate over his previous debates. He is listening to her, Kellyanne. Kellyanne has got him doing exactly what she wants him to do. His mission was to stand there, look presidential. Don't piss your pants, and don't stab her on the stage. I think he took direction and did exactly what she wanted him to do. What he did the other night was miles ahead of his performance on any other debate, and I believe that he was told to rein it in. I believe he did exactly what she wanted him to do, and I think their strategy is going to be, we want more people coming to the next debate. We want Hillary to shoot her wad. She threw everything she could at him. She did not draw blood. She didn't get him riled. She didn't get him upset. Kellyanne has the man restrained like he's never been before.
Well, okay. Now she's out and her slide is locked back.
That's right.
She's done shot
she's
it.
She's thrown everything at him and it did no good. And Trump took it. Took it.
Except for the mainstream media, you know, try to make more out of it than what it is.
Exactly.
And to put legs on the story.
But you look at all the polls, and we did this on Monday, an aggregate of all the polls about who won the debate, and all of them together put it about 68-69% to Donald Trump and about 35% to Hillary. So it was a lopsided thing, about 2-1. People think he won the debate, and that's really all that matters. Okay. Meanwhile, what we have is 80 million people, about 20 million of which weren't even considering Donald Trump before. Now they're saying, you know what? He may be able to do this. And now we've got millions of dollars, tens of millions of dollars coming out, hundreds of million dollars probably, coming out for the Trumpocrats. And we're going to have Democrats voting for Donald Trump in huge, huge numbers. That debate wasn't to win the election. That debate was to court the Democrats.
I think it's a process.
Yep.
You know, I don't think Donald Trump lost any of his supporters.
Not a one.
No. And we know that more independents are on the side of Trump than on Hillary's side.
Yep. And we know that a lot of the Democrats were watching the debate. And his goal was to look presidential, to hit her with some good stuff. Not everything you got. He's not going to shoot his load like she did. And she emptied her gun, like you said, slides back. She's got nothing left to throw at him. Her next debate, all she can do is rehash her talking points. While he
could come back with, that's old news. You got anything new?
That's right. And he'll slough it off. And he won't even reply to her. My guess is he won't reply to her. Oh, and he went bankrupt. He will come back with country. Not even that. Country after country after country that she took money from to her private organization, got contracts, got bids, got all sorts of benefits from it.
To bring up what her and Bill did in Haiti.
Exactly. He will bring all of that stuff up factually and hit her while she's out of ammo.
Yeah, don't even respond to her allegations. Just bring up...
Exactly.
You know,
and he does, he's doing exactly what Carrie Ann's told him to do. People say he needs to listen to a debate person. He is. And Carrie Ann is strategically building this thing. And it's going to be devastating the next debate. It's going to be devastating because she's got nothing left. He hasn't really fired but one round.
I'm looking forward to the VP debates.
Yeah, that's coming up. I believe that's next week.
And then
about a week after that, we're going to have Trump and Hillary back on stage. And it's going to be more of a town hall thing, so the questions will come from the field. But I don't think Trump's going to be doing a lot of answering the questions that they want. I think he's going to be talking about, that's a great question to see. It'll be, Mr. Trump, you say you're a good businessman, but you filed bankruptcy 4 times. I'm glad you asked that question, because Hillary Clinton did this. Hillary Clinton did that. Hillary Clinton got 4 people killed in Benghazi and then sits there in front of the Congress and says, what difference does it make? Hillary Clinton lost $6 billion while she was Secretary of the State. How do you lose $6 billion? He'll talk about what Kelly wants him to talk about. And it's going to be a great debate. I don't think he lost anything. I think he did exactly what he needed to do. And I didn't have to wait an extra 10 hours to decide this. I was cheering him on during the debate. So I'm excited. I think we're already beating her in, I believe it's 8 of the battleground states. We're closing the gap in the other 4. There's no way. There's no way, unless he absolutely just doesn't show up at the debates. This thing is pretty much done. He's going to take...
I don't think that's going
to
happen.
He's going to take Colorado. He's going to take Nevada. He's going to take Pennsylvania. He's already got Iowa. He's got Ohio. He's got Florida. He's going to get Georgia. It's a lock. She cannot win without most of these states. And the important ones are already pretty much in his pocket. So it's a great thing. It's a great day for America. And we're going to take another quick break, play another great message. Please, my friends, listen to these messages. They are powerful, powerful things. Stick around. Mike, we'll be right back, brother. Did you play that Machado thing I posted earlier?
What, on Trump and Gal?
Yeah.
No, I haven't had a chance. I can do that now.
Yeah, scroll
up. I got it saved.
Scroll up and watch it. We'll talk about it when we come back.
All righty then.
Stick around. It's the Patriot Radio Show on a Thursday morning with Tom O'Halloran and Mike Nelson.
If I wanted America to fail, to follow, not lead, to suffer, not prosper, to despair, not dream, I'd start with energy. And they did. The Keystone Pipeline, the war on coal, endless environmental lawsuits aimed at expanding federal power. They sure started with energy, but they didn't stop there.
I said this once or twice, but it bears repeating.
You can keep your plan if you are satisfied with it.
If you like your health care plan, you'll be able to keep your health care plan.
If you like your plan and you like your doctor, you won't have to do a thing. You keep your plan. You like your current insurance, you keep that insurance.
Period. Many Americans didn't get to keep their plan or their doctor. And as federal tentacles snake their way deeper into America's $2.5 trillion healthcare sector, many politicians voted to spare themselves the pain of their own policies. Policies they insisted would be good for the masses. Those politicians need a lesson in civics, because we are not the masses. In this country, we've never been, nor have we ever considered ourselves, the proletariat, the herd, or the hoi polloi, the mob or the common folk, the rabble or the riffraff. No, for 237 years, we, the American people, have not been subjects. We have been sovereign. We remain sovereign. And every 2 years on Election Day, we exercise our powers as sovereign. Our leaders in Washington would do well to remember that fact, particularly as they determine the power of federal bureaucracies. I make cheap energy expensive, so that expensive energy would seem cheap. You see, environmentalists don't use force. They don't need to. They don't even need lawmakers anymore. Instead, they use lawsuits to short-circuit the rule of law and expand bureaucratic control over things like residential wood burning, as in the kind that heats millions of homes in the winter. Many rural families may be forced to spend thousands to comply with new regulations if they can afford to comply at all. I would empower unelected bureaucrats to all but outlaw America's most abundant sources of energy. Welcome to Alabama, red state. For months, environmental interests have been waging a campaign here to kill coal. Of course, they can't say that to the conservative voters of Alabama. So instead, environmental front groups are pretending to care about the cost of electricity. It's a joke. And their money betrays their true intentions. New reports reveal that San Francisco-based environmental interests are funneling millions to the very Alabama front groups now seeking to hijack the state's Public Service Commission. Millions flowing from California to radical environmental groups in Alabama, all part of a backdoor effort to bring down the free market in the very heart of a conservative stronghold. Don't let them get away with it, Alabama. Whether they serve in Congress in Washington, work at a federal agency, or sit on the Public Service Commission in Alabama, our public officials were not empowered to negotiate the slow surrender of our freedoms. And the cause of energy independence is the cause of freedom. Let not our children say that this cause was quietly forsaken by those who profess to lead it. Let not history say that we deserted our principles when they were most in need of a vigorous defense. Let it be said that we saw things clearly, even when it was difficult. That we stood up, spoke out, and fought back.
Attention, patriots and conservative Americans. Have you ever wondered why the Tea Party did so well in 2010, but has not accomplished much since? Have you ever wondered where your money goes when you donate to these various national Tea Party groups, and then what do they do with it? The new blockbuster book, Ego in a Teabag, written by Ken Crow, an original Tea Party organizer and activist, is a tell-all about the seedy side of the Tea Party. Ego in a Teabag exposes the corruption, greed, and deceit behind this great American movement. Along with the exposing of the bat, the book also details how the Tea Party will become the most powerful political organization in America in the coming years. Order your copy today from Amazon.com to be released at the end of April. Just click on the picture of Ken's book on PatriotRadioShow.com and reserve your copy of Ego in a Teabag today.
Tom O'Halloran.
We'll put a boot in your ass. It's the American way. All brought to you courtesy of the red, white, and blue.
And we are back. It's the Patriot Radio Show with Tom O'Halloran and my good friend, Mike Nelson. Mike, did you get a chance to watch that video?
Yes, I did. Yeah. He was supportive of her.
What a hateful guy, isn't he?
This is how she repays him.
What a hateful guy, wasn't he? Donald Trump just tore this poor girl apart. He was loving toward her. He complimented her, said she was the most beautiful woman he'd ever seen. She's gushing.
Well, he also said others wanted to give her the Jonah toss, and he didn't want to.
Right? Right? And he told the guys that were interviewing, doing the media guys, you could all stand to lose a few pounds yourself. So everything he said was nice about her. And she's gushing. She's inviting him to work out. It was not a hateful thing. If he was saying bad things and shaming her, she would not invite him to come down and work out with her. Not in any way, shape, or form. So it's a whole media concoction between the media and the Hillary campaign. The two of them almost looked like they were in love. I mean, he was praising her. She was gushing. She's inviting him to come down. She was a pretty girl.
She was, and she still is.
Yeah, but now she's kind of got this.
Now she's ugly on the inside.
Yeah, she's ugly on the inside.
For what she did.
And I don't know what happened. It may not have been that she was bought off. I'm thinking it probably was. But Trump may have spurned her. There's no fury greater than a woman scorned. She may have had designs on him in a romantic situation, you know, going after the money, and he spurned her. That could have been what drove her to do this. I don't know. All we can do is speculate. But what we do have is we have the videotape of her talking about her weight, and it was one of concern, one of compassion, one of support, and it came from the heart. You can tell that just by listening to the media coverage of it. So, anyway, in the chat room, people are talking, I'm not sure who brought it up, about having Milo do the next debate. He would be good. He would be good. I love Milo. He's the most well-known flaming, I guess the word he uses is flaming fag.
Isn't that true that they kicked him off of Twitter?
Yeah, yep. They kicked him off of Twitter. He's a homosexual, a flaming fag, as he says, and he's a conservative, and it's just driving the left bananas. He goes to give a speech at a college, and the college refuses to, the students refuse to let him on the campus and stuff. He would do a great debate, but he would be the show, and that's not what we want. That's not the point of a debate.
And the way the left is so twisted, they don't dare criticize him.
Yeah.
Well, you homophobe?
Right.
he's hoisted on their own petard.
He's a character. I've watched several of his speeches. I love the guy. He's out there, is out there in a flaming homosexual manner as you can be, and he's a conservative. It's kind of hard to wrap your head around, but he's a great guy, and he's fun to watch on stage because he talks the truth, and he doesn't pander to these politically correct pussies on campus that need a safe space. He calls them out for being so politically correct. But that's not what we want for debate moderator. We want somebody that's serious. We want somebody that's not the center of attention.
We don't turn it into a Saturday Night Live skit.
Right, and he couldn't not be the center of attention. That's just who he is. So he's a great guy, a good conservative. I've got huge respect for him for what he puts up with. But no, debate moderator, no. And, okay, we're going to say the word Kardashians next topic. We've covered the Kardashians. You heard me say it, so that's done. Moving along now. Let's see, what else have we got? Oh,
where was I? I don't remember the covering the Kardashians.
I just did. I said the word.
Oh, I said the word. Okay, I get
okay.
it.
Okay, that's
move along. Nothing to see here.
Exactly. We were talking about before we went into the break. I mentioned Hillary's trying to attack Bill or attack Donald Trump at the next debate, and I said, you filed bankruptcy four times. Bill Perryman, the guy that was supposed to be my co-host today, but threw me under the bus. Bill says,
he
how many
pay his bills?
What's that?
Because he didn't pay his bills.
Right.
His phone bills.
He says, how many declared bankruptcy due to Obama and Hillary's policies, the Democrats' policies? 100,000, probably more. Probably
you're tweaking your melon, Bill.
Probably close to a million. Yeah, he knows we're tweaking him. He knows that. I answered him when he asked that question in the chat room. I said, excellent point, my former friend. And listen, in all seriousness, I appreciate you, Mike, stepping in and doing this when...
no problem. When I was kind of waiting for you to ask me, and then I thought, he said he's going to leave, kibosh the show. No, I can't have that.
Well, no, I'm glad you did, because my head wasn't even there to do that. I'm like, I was counting on doing this. Now I don't. And yeah, I'm glad you thought of
it. You probably had it all prepped to talk to Bill because there's things you wanted him to talk about with.
Well, there are things that we had been talking about because we do this from about 6 o'clock every morning. We're in the chat. We're sharing stories back and forth and stuff. And we basically had the show lined up with the stuff we were going to cover. And then
I know you normally do the jihad on Friday thing.
Yeah.
Perhaps, if Bill gets his phone working, you can do that tomorrow.
I'll probably have a new friend by tomorrow. One that won't.
Hey, I got a choice for the next debate moderator.
Yeah.
How about Gonzo Ted Nugent?
Yeah, there you go. See, and I would love that. I love this guy. The ticket that I've been praying for 8 years now was Ted Nugent and Chuck Norris. And I don't care which one's at the top of the ticket. I mean,
poison.
Yeah, that is a campaign that would involve some serious ass kickery.
Ass kickery.
But we,
I like that one. I must write that down.
I've used that for years. I love that word. But us picking him is like them picking this lefty Holt. It's somebody that would be obviously not fair and balanced. He'd be on us, and they wouldn't approve it. They wouldn't do a debate.
Okay. Who was that cow that was on The View that everybody hated? What was her name?
Which one? We hate them all.
The white one with the...
Oh, the one the Democrats...
God, I keep wanting to say Roseanne Barr, but it's not Roseanne Barr.
No.
The rabid anti-gunner.
Angie Gunner?
Anti-gunner.
I don't know. I mean, all of them were hateful people, other than the one blonde that ended up going to Fox. Is she still doing the morning show on the Fox?
I don't know.
The one conservative that was on The View, she left The View, or maybe she didn't, but she started doing the morning show on Fox.
Maybe somebody in the chat room can give me a
I don't know
on who that was. It'll probably pop into my head here in a minute.
Even on Fox, I don't watch shows with sofas. I mean, if they've got sofas and they're inviting guests in, and the morning shows, no matter what channel it is, it's the same crap. And I just don't watch those. Never have, never will. Even the Fox one that's a little bit later in the day, where they've got Outnumbered. Even that one, I don't care for. Number one, where did McCain's daughter become a talking head? What has she ever done other than have a dad that's a senator?
Yeah.
Every time she addresses a topic, it's like, what the hell do you know? Nothing.
Isn't she the one that's a lesbian or something? Am I thinking somebody else?
I'm thinking you're probably right, because I can't imagine any guy finding anything about that attractive.
Hmm.
So, could well be.
Well, I don't know for sure, but I'm thinking that that's it.
Yeah. But I don't watch Fox. I mean, they've got some of the absolute most gorgeous women on TV. Even Megyn Kelly. I would take Megyn Kelly as long as I could duct tape her mouth. She's absolutely stunning. Stunningly gorgeous, but she is definitely not my cup of tea politically.
I watch the Fox and Friends when we get up this morning and for a coffee and breakfast and that. But
yeah, I don't even.
Then I turn it off and I get online and start looking for news.
I don't get see Catherine's getting kicked off the show. Casey, are they bumping you? Okay, this
kicked off the show.
The NSA. NSA, listen, stop picking on these people. Okay, you know where I'm at. You want me? Come and get me.
Well, she said earlier she was having internet trouble.
Well, yeah.
I had that earlier this week.
Well, she's a girl. She may not know how to get on the internet.
Your show kept cutting out and cutting out. No, it was me or you.
I give her a hard time for being a girl, but she's pretty smart for a girl. Actually, she's,
hey, I got a question.
Let me clear this up. I need to clear this up before you continue, brother.
All right. Continue.
I was giving her a hard time, and I need to get it real clear. Kat is one of the smartest people I know. So go ahead.
Well, my wife works in human resources at a bus company here in town. And I asked her, I said, is it really true that women don't get paid as much as men for doing the same job anymore?
It is true. They shouldn't get paid. It's based on your performance. It's not just that you are a bookkeeper
There's a man and a woman, and they're both doing the same job. Do they get the equal pay?
Have they been doing it for the same length of time? Do they take the same number of days off?
Is it true that women are downtrodden? And you know, is this war on women true?
No,
that's what I was trying to get through.
No,
you know?
It's not. It's not true at all. The gap.
And I don't know the office thing.
The gap in pay between them is based upon performance.
Hillary moment.
Yeah, performance, how well they do the job, how many days they take off, how many hours they work, how long they've been on the job. It's based on a lot of things. And if you are doing this exact same quality of work for the same length of time, in almost every case out there, you'll be earning the same amount of pay.
So it's not just cut and dry, it's nuanced.
It's very nuanced.
Experience and, okay.
Guys often will work overtime more than women will because women need to get home and do the family thing, and that's kind of a maternal thing, and there's nothing wrong with that. But you
what I was basically looking for was a woman's perspective. Now, here's two dudes, me and you, talking about it. You know, I'd like to get a woman's take on the thing. Because we always hear that, woman vote, you know, they're against Trump.
You want a woman's view on it?
Look how many women he's hired to do these fantastic jobs and be in charge.
Right. You want a women's view? What would they know? Brother, we're at the top of the show. I want to thank you again for coming in and doing this. Thanks.
Time flies when you're having fun.
Right? Well, when you're well prepared like I am, it's easy. God bless you and yours, America. This is Tom O'Halloran and Mike Nelson. We are so out of here. Tune in tomorrow morning for another episode of Jihad on America.